Voy a dar mi conferencia en inglés, que es para él. But I first wanted to thank Gabriel, Patty, Daniel, Agatha, and the translators for putting on such a marvelous celebration. I teach literature, although I'm going to try to talk about pictures. Let's see how this goes. I'm one of the generation of scholars who never met Leonora Carrington, a condition that will now become the norm forever. It's ultimately inevitable for all of us to no longer meet our ancestors. This painting, or this painting, this picture, it's a print. The Memory Tower is a self-portrait. It is a self-portrait not only of the artist Leonora Carrington, but of the viewer, of me, of you, as we do the work of interpreting it. We squint to find the living shapes within the concentric structures of the Memory Tower. So do we approach an artist, even a living artist, through the mortal veil of her work, as we heard from Katrina. We squint to discern. But this is also, perhaps most of all, I'd like to suggest, a portrait of Leonora's art itself. And in my presentation today, I'll try to explain what this means. The Memory Tower depicts both a ruin and a living system, a testament to the history of memory systems themselves and the poignancy of their resilience in the face of death. Next. The very idea of memory palace or memory tower comes to us from Simonides, from Cicero. And I'm not sure if this is legible in any language, but I will read it anyway. This is from Hilary Mantel's novel Wolf Hall, which is a very condensed version. And I'll be reading the English. Once in Thessaly, there was a poet called Simonides. He was commissioned to appear at a banquet given by a man called Scopas and recite a lyric in praise of his host. Poets have strange vagaries, and in his lyric, Simonides incorporated verses in praise of Castor and Pollux, the heavenly twins. Scopas was sulky, so said he would pay only half the fee. As for the rest, get it from the twins. A little later, a servant came into the hall. He whispered to Simonides. There were two young men outside, asking for him by name. He rose and left the banqueting hall. He looked around for the two young men, but he could see no more. As he turned back to go finish his dinner, he heard a terrible noise of stone splitting and crumbling. He heard the cries of the dying as the roof of the hall collapsed. Of all the diners, he was the only one left alive. The bodies were so broken and disfigured that the relatives of the dead could not identify them. But Simonides was a remarkable man. Yes, whatever he saw was imprinted on his mind. He led each of the relatives through the ruins, and pointing to the crushed remains, he said, "There is your man." In linking the dead to their names, he worked from the seating plan in his head. It is Cicero who tells us the story. He tells us how, on that day, Simonides invented the art of memory. He remembered the names, the faces, some sour and bloated, some blithe, some bored. He remembered exactly where everyone was sitting at the moment the roof fell in. The art of memory emerges from disaster. So we've heard this origin story of the idea of a memory palace, and we see most famously in Francis Yates's 1966 study of the art of memory, a genealogy of memory palaces that I would like to suggest find their shapes in Leonora's work. We have the ladder of ascent and descent from Raymond Lulz, which shows us the different stages to get up to the Tower of Memory. We have a tree of memory, or a tree of life, which has its own set of complements, as we've already heard. And in this genealogy, we also have the memory theater, aspiration, tree of life, and theater. But as I mentioned, the palace of memory is a reconstruction of what begins in cataclysm, in falling, in disaster. We have complements, for example, in the falling towers, ultimate, I don't have my slides marked, the ultimate memory palace might be the palace of the Rosicrucians. But they emerge from disaster, so we see this in the tarot, both the 1909 modern Rider-Waite deck and the Devil de Marseille much earlier. But the other compliment for this, and I would like to remember that in our Carrington's Memory Tower is a work from 1995, considers and memorializes another disaster of the roof falling in, which is the Mexico City earthquake. As many of you know, Leonora left Mexico for several years after the 1985 earthquake that devastated Mexico City. The Memory Tower is a testament not only to abstract histories of memory, but to the cataclysm itself 10 years after the fact, memorializing her return to Mexico after several years in New York and Chicago. I believe I have another slide, just for the sake of... Her friend Homero Adiges recently wrote of the earthquake on the occasion of its 30th anniversary 2 years ago, recalling Leonora as a witness. As he writes, I don't have this quote, 3 decades later, Avenida Juarez is on the way to regaining its former splendor. Other streets in the city have never recovered, such as Chihuahua, home to surrealist painter Leonora Carrington until her death in 2011. Across the street from her house, the remains of a 10-story building, ostensibly a solid mass, have been colonized by squatters, and so forth. The Memory Tower, I'll get to this. The Memory Tower is a memorial to this cataclysm, as well as a reminder of the place of cataclysm within the art of memory. Memory is not just a palace, or a theater, or merely an abstract system. It is also a ruin. Moving on, though, and I'm going to be shifting from Francis Yeats to the Irish poet William Butler Yeats to suggest the nobility of ruin that is also part of this work and of this thought. Yeats, as we'll see, was himself a collector of towers and who thought of himself in self-portrait terms. So I want to think about a kind of self-portrait that William Butler Yeats writes of himself in Sailing to Byzantium. An aged man, he writes, is but a paltry thing, a tattered coat upon a stick, unless soul clap its hands and sing, and louder sing, for every tatter in its mortal dress. And we are lucky to have a photograph of Leonora's own coat upon a stick. In The Hearing Trumpet, we find an analogous and recursive recollection of similar ideas when Leonora writes of the architectural forms of life. Houses, she writes, are really bodies. This is actually Marion Leatherby. Houses are really bodies. We connect ourselves with walls, roofs, and objects just as we hang on to our livers, skeletons, flesh, and bloodstream. I am no beauty. No mirror is necessary to assure me of this absolute fact. Nevertheless, I have a death grip on this haggard frame, as if it were the limpid body of Venus herself. Another self-portrait of Carrington in this mode of reflection. Here is Yeats's tower, Torre Balili, which became the site of Yeats's similar memory system, similar ways of condensing both autobiography, self-portraiture, and, let's say, the history of memory itself in architectural form. In the tower, Yeats's famous 1928 poem, he asks, the speaker asks, "What shall I do with this absurdity?" He's speaking of his own frame. "Oh heart, oh troubled heart, this caricature, decrepit age that has been tied to me as to a dog's tail." But like Marion Weatherby, the response is not to think of the ruin of one's own aging frame as something to be sad about or to mourn, but rather to grip onto in total defiance. His response, "Never had I more excited, passionate, fantastical imagination, nor an ear and eye that more expected the impossible." The memory at stake in such portraits of aging and survival is not just that of cataclysm, but of great memory, the poetic memory, the wisdom of the ages, the wisdom of life and death. And I'm going to skip quickly through a bit more Yeats here, so apologies to the translator. Yeats continues to talk about what this memory looks like, and again, he, like Leonora, combines castle, ruin, and tree. As you can see the tree in this too. Yeats writes, "I pace on the battlements and stare on the foundations of a house, or where a tree, like a sooty finger, starts from the earth and send imagination forth under the day's declining beam and call images and memories from ruin or from ancient tree, for I would ask a question of them all." For Yeats, this question calls soul into being, but it's also promised to keep on going until his body turns into clouds. The body decays, but the tower stands, its ruination subject to a different temporality, and thus generative of new things. In Leonora's work, which we see in a late example from 1995 here, I propose that this Yeatsian idea of soul opens up to this twin sense of humorous myth and also of political intensity and deep sadness as well. The idea of the Tower of Memory as being generative, we can see in all kinds of forms within this. For example, in the idea that inside the tower is the cave or labyrinth and a kind of womb reproducing more forms. It's a gesture we often see in Leonora's work. The egg, the womb, the new body. We have towers resplendently throughout The Hearing Trumpet, which frame the novel's apocalyptic moments and offer their own scenes of rebirth. The memory tower is an artificial womb. Carrington's fantastic architecture throughout her career is not only fantastic in its forms, but also populated with fantastic beings. We see in the memory tower a very simple, modest engraving, somehow, still as a repository of all of these types of figures. So, the tower. I'll skip the story. So. But I will say that, just to give you a microcosm, it is under the aegis of this tower, literally within this ruined tower, that Marion Weatherby is reborn as herself, as her own twin. And this image of twins and twinning, brings us back to Castor and Pollux from the Simonides story, as well as from Max Ernst's version of Castor y Pollution. We see twins paired within the imaginary of one's own rebirth. And we just see figures. I'm just going to go through a very series of figures here. Figurations, keep going, please. Recollective and recursive throughout Eddington's career that come back and back again. And so in the forms of the Tower of Memory, we see the shapes of the Minotaur, we see the Samain, the veiled figures, who are also butterflies. Lepidopterus. Madame Dupin, with the same figures, find their way within the figurations of the final January Tower. I think this is the final one. Okay. It was very quick. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.